good evening and welcome to Arizona Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. Democratic State Representative Ben Arredondo is expected to plead guilty tomorrow to federal charges involving public corruption. Earlier this year, Arredondo was indicted on allegations that he took tickets for sporting events from real estate developers in exchange for helping facilitate land deals. The developers turned out to be FBI agents running a sting operation. Arredondo pleaded not guilty to corruption charges in May, but a change of plea hearing is now set for tomorrow in U.S. District Court. The United States Supreme Court began its new session this week, and with the new term comes another Arizona case to be considered. The High Court has agreed to hear an Arizona death penalty case that will be argued by State Attorney General Tom Horn. Here to talk about that case and give us a preview of the court session is ASU Law Professor Paul Bender. Always good to see you. Thanks for
joining
us.
Nice to see you, Ted.
Before we get to specifics, what is this going to be a big session for the court?
You don't know yet. Right now, they've taken one case that's going to be argued next week that's potentially very important. That's a challenge to the affirmative action program at the University of Texas. There are on the horizon some cases that could be really important, like some gay marriage-related cases, but we don't know if they're going to take those or not. And even with the case, the affirmative action case, you don't know whether the case is going to be a landmark case until it's decided and they write the opinion, because the opinion can be very narrow or it can be very broad.
Interesting. All right, let's get to Arizona. We're always there, Paul. It seems like we're always around as far as the
Supreme. Does seem to be lately, yeah.
Yeah. Is that Ryan versus Gonzalez, a death penalty case involving what, competency?
It's an interesting case. It's not terribly important, except, of course, to the parties involved. But it's an interesting issue. It's a death penalty case. They have two of them. Another one from the Sixth Circuit, where the defendant was convicted, went through his state post-conviction remedies, and is asking for federal habeas corpus. And after he brings his federal habeas corpus petition, he becomes mentally incompetent. And in this case, it's pretty clear that he did become mentally incompetent. And his lawyers go to court and say, put this thing on hold because we need to consult with him in order to present his case, because the issues in his federal habeas involve issues that he knows about. We weren't his lawyers then. He's had 10 different lawyers. And so it's really important to have his cooperation. And he can't cooperate because he doesn't know what's going on. So put this thing on hold until his mental condition improves, which maybe never. And in this case, the Ninth Circuit held that it should be stayed until his mental health improves. And if it never improves, then they can't ever execute him.
And that is the issue, is it not? I mean, you have a de facto, we're not going to impose a death penalty here.
That would be true if the Ninth Circuit decision stands. On the other hand, if you say, too bad, we're going to go ahead and hear the habeas, and if, in fact, his participation would be helpful to him, and he can't participate because of a mental condition, then that's not fair to him. And you may end up executing somebody who shouldn't be executed. So it's a real dilemma for the courts. The Ninth Circuit and the Sixth Circuit both decided that you ought to stay the proceedings and leave it up to the district judge to find out, one, is he competent, and two, is his participation really helpful or necessary to his lawyers. And if he is incompetent and it is necessary, stay it. If the issues are ones that don't involve him and his participation is necessary, then don't stay it. The question is, will the Supreme Court leave that up to the lower courts, or will it say, no, you can't do this because it's an indefinite state of the death penalty?
I think
that's what they'll do. They'll say, you can't do this. You have to go ahead with the proceeding. You can't indefinitely stay it.
Right.
Maybe you can stay it for a few months or even a year, but if there's no real chance of him getting better, that you're not going to permit. I don't think they're going to permit the lower federal courts to put off executions indefinitely.
And that might mean executing someone who doesn't understand what's happening to him.
Well, that's a different issue. If he really doesn't understand what's happening to him in the execution, why he's being executed, then you cannot execute him. Somebody, in order to be executable, has to understand what's going on. But that's a different test from, is he competent enough to participate with his lawyers? He could understand what's going on enough to be executed, but not understand enough what's going on to help his lawyers. So that is true, that ultimately you can't execute him if he's so out of it that he doesn't know what's happening. But that's not necessarily the same thing as incompetent to help your lawyers.
Interesting. Okay, a couple other Arizona cases may or may not be heard. One involves voter registration, the other domestic partner benefits. Do we know what's going to happen with these two cases?
Not yet. One of those cases was on the conference list last week. And we thought the court would either take it or deny it, but they haven't acted on it yet. That's the case that involves a domestic partnership arrangement. Janet Napolitano, when she was governor, changed the rules and said that state employees could get health benefits for their domestic partners, whether they were same-sex partnerships or different-sex partnerships, they could get health benefits. And Governor Brewer didn't like that, and she changed that, and the legislature has now passed a statute which says health benefits for state employees only go to the spouses and children, no domestic partners, either same-sex domestic partners or heterosexual domestic partners. And that was challenged as a violation of the Equal Protection Clause because it is said that it was intended to discriminate against gay couples and that it had that effect. And the Ninth Circuit, a panel opinion by Judge Mary Schroeder, who used to be chief judge, held that it was unconstitutional. And there was a petition for rehearing in bank, which was denied, but the court's most conservative judge, Ninth Circuit's conservative, wrote an opinion dissenting from the denial and saying, this is wrong. And I think the Supreme Court's going to take that case seriously, both because of that. It's a very interesting case. It's a difficult case to know what to do, because the Supreme Court has never said that discrimination on the grounds of sexual orientation is a suspect kind of discrimination. They've always treated it as like any other kind of discrimination, subject to just a rational basis test. So all the government has to show is that there's a reason for doing it, where if a suspect classification, they have to have a compelling reason. And in this case, Mary Schroeder said they needed a compelling reason. And the court has never said that about discrimination against gays. So later in the term, the court's going to consider whether to take some gay marriage-related cases involving, for example, the Federal Defense of Marriage Act, which is being challenged on more or less the same grounds. And I think there's a good chance they'll hold this until they see what they want to do with those, and then maybe take this, or even if they don't take it, hold it and decide the issue and then apply it to this case. So that's a potentially important case.
What about the voter registration?
The voting registration case is on tomorrow's conference list. Okay. And we should know by next Monday whether they're going to take that one or not. That is a challenge to Proposition 200, I think it was, which requires you to have some documentary proof of citizenship in order to register to vote. There's been a lot of controversy recently about identification requirements when you go to vote. This is not when you go to vote. This is when you go to register. And in 1993, the federal government passed something that's called the Motor Voter Act, which was intended to make it easier to register to vote. And in fact, they have to let you register when you register your car, when you get a driver's license. It's meant to make it very easy. And it says there's a federal form that has to be used by the state. And the federal form does not require documentary proof of citizenship. The state, however, the state law requires documentary proof of citizenship. So the question is whether that state law is preempted by the federal law. And the Ninth Circuit held that it was. And that was an embanked decision. And I think there was only one or two dissents. It seems to me that it's probably right, and the court might deny it. But on the other hand, it's an issue that's really interesting to people now, and it's the Ninth Circuit deciding a civil liberty, civil rights-related case on the liberal side, so there's a very good chance the court will take that.
All right, we'll keep an eye on that. When you mentioned this earlier as a big case, this Fisher v. University of Texas, we're talking admission stuff. I thought all this was sudden. Wasn't there a Michigan case years ago?
It's not all that long ago. In 2003, there was a Michigan law school case in which the Supreme Court, an opinion by Justice O'Connor, 5-4 opinion, held that law schools and other undergraduate institutions, educational institutions generally, can use race as one of many factors in admissions decisions in order to get a diverse class. That was a 5-4 decision. If that case had come up after Justice Alito replaced Justice O'Connor, it would have come out the other way, I think, pretty clearly. So now Justice Alito has replaced Justice O'Connor. And one big question in that case is, will the court overrule, it's called the Grutter case, the 2003 case, will they overrule it and say, as they did not say there, that you can never use race as a factor in admissions? There were four people who wanted to say that in 2003. There may now be five. On the other hand, we have a court led by a Chief Justice who says that he is not into overruling cases and he wants stability in the law. And as you may remember, at the end of the last term, he appeared to some people to be becoming a judicial statesman, and he was going to bring the court together and stop the partisan bickering. It'll be really interesting to see whether that shows up here or whether the court will say, we're going to overrule that case, we think it's wrong.
And real interesting, in as far as this Texas case is concerned, it sounds as though, and correct me if I'm wrong, is the state of Texas has already decided to accept like the top 10%, no matter who you are, no matter what high school you're going to. And so maybe diversity is already being shown.
Right. That's the narrow ground on which the court can, and I think should, and may very well actually decide the case. That is, when it looked like you could not use race at all, because the Fifth Circuit, where Texas is, decided that you couldn't, the University of Texas, which had a plan that was struck down because it used race, said, but we really want diversity. And so they adopted a statute which says that if you're in the top 10% of your class at a Texas high school, you have a right to get into the University of Texas at whatever campus you want to go to. And that produced a lot of diversity. Ironically, that produced a lot of diversity because Texas has segregated schools. And so you have a lot of segregated schools where minorities are almost the entire school. And so the top 10% of the class is very heavily minority. And so that resulted in a very substantial amount of diversity. Then when the Supreme Court decided in 2003 that you could use race in a limited way as a factor, Texas said, well, we want to do that too, because we don't have as much diversity as we'd like to have. It's true we have a fairly large percentage of Hispanics and blacks, but there are departments of the university where there is no diversity. And we would like to look at the people applying and try to admit people who will diversify the economics department, the physics department, and stuff like that. And that's the issue in this case. Are they entitled to, even when they already have a lot of diversity in the university as a whole, are they entitled to take race into account to try to make sure that different departments and majors and schools of the university are also diverse?
What do you think is going to happen?
In that case, I would think that the chances are that the court will decide on a very narrow ground that they already have enough diversity, and they can't use this. They can only use it when you don't have any, because four of them don't want to let you use race at all. And I think Justice Kennedy is the swing vote, and he has always been opposed to the use of race. But I don't think he's ready to say you can never use race. And so I would think that he would be the fifth vote for a narrow decision which says Texas can't do it because they already had it on a non-racial basis.
Before we let you go, expecting fireworks anytime during this? I mean, the last session closed with a bang. We talked about big cases earlier on. You mentioned this University of Texas case, a biggie. You thinking any fireworks?
Oh, there could be fireworks there. For example, if the court overrules the Grutter case and says suddenly you can't use race at all, there will be some people on the court who are very upset with that, and they will let you know that they're upset. And if the gay marriage issue comes up later, you can imagine the same thing could be true
there. All right. It's always good to see you. Thanks for joining us. We appreciate
it. Same here, Ted.